Yes, good evening. Yes, today I want us to pick from where we left. And in our previous class, we were looking at the trustee. And we say that a trustee is someone who's been given the powers or the rights of ensuring that the property of the bankrupt is shared in a fair and equitable manner to the existing creditors, such that the debts are prioritized and they are cleared as required by the Bankruptcy and Insolvency Act. So we were able to look at the divisible property, and we said the first thing that will happen after the appointment of the trustee is to come up with a committee of inspection that will be formed by 3 to 5 creditors. Of course, those who are taking quite a significant amount of debt. So the trustee will be given the powers to go ahead and administer or share this property. Then we went through the debtor's property after the commencement of the bankruptcy. And in that category, we were able to look at the protected transactions. We were able to look at the other properties that will be owned. And I want us to look at now the property in bankrupt's reputed ownership. So the trustee may claim property owned by third parties, which is in the bankrupt's possession at the commencement of the bankruptcy. Now, if this happens after the trustee receives what we call the official communication, or after the official receiver communicates the information that we have a bankrupt case, now there are those properties that will have been transferred or owned by the third parties. Yeah, so the property may consist of goods, they may be business debts in sole possession, or they are disposed of at the commencement of the bankruptcy. Could be these items were goods or merchandise that had been purchased to run this particular venture, of course, with the consent of the true owner. So in such circumstances, the debtor is the reputed owner of the goods. So the trustee may be defeated by evidence of the trade custom of possession of such goods if he or she cannot guarantee or show cause the ownership. Yeah? Then we have the property that is or was transferred before the bankruptcy. And this could have happened through what we call the voluntary settlement. I will leave this bigger part for you to try and understand. And this, the voluntary settlement, actually these are or what we call the inter vivos. Those items that were bequeathed when the bankrupt person was doing well. So you cannot again go back and start claiming when a situation of bankruptcy has arisen. Then we have agreements that had been put in between two people. And by agreement, I mean, there was a write-up, of course, that was witnessed by a commissioner of oath or an advocate to show how the various agreements or the settlement will be done. Then we have the fraudulent preferences. And we say that the trustee has the power to set aside any suspicious transaction within the 6 months preceding the presentation. We say some people can be so cunning. because I know I've been declared, or rather I'm going to declare myself bankrupt in the near future, I can start doing some fraudulent conveyances where I transfer most of the wealth or the net worth to other sources so that it is not reachable by the creditors. So what the trustee will do, that is what we call the assignment of book debts, where the trustee set aside the existing or future book debts, could be absolute or otherwise, by a way of charging. Yeah, and by charging we mean at the time of the assignment from the specified debtors, or what was growing under specified contracts, or it was included in a bona fide transfer of the business for value. And we had talked about the bona fide transfers earlier, or they were included in an assignment of assets for the benefit of the creditors generally. Now, these assignments of books will now help the trustee do or be able to charge, but this cannot happen unless or in the prevailing situations, we have a registered absolute bill to do so. Then we have the disclaimer of onerous property. By onerous, I mean burdensome or what is difficult. And the trustee may disclaim the difficult property. And this may consist of land burden with onerous covenants. You could find a piece of land that has been given several undertakings. And this is the argument. If the land is sitting on a mother title, and then the bankruptcy, let's say, took several undertakings with the same land, is already a burdensome transaction. It is onerous, yeah? Or stocks and shares. And we know that the movement of the, or the pricing of the stocks is influenced by the forces of demand and supply. So this is not something that the trustee can be able to control, and therefore they can disclaim. Then we have unprofitable contracts. For example, if the bankrupt person had entered into a contract, let's say of mining, where you are supposed to be paying royalties, and this time, you know the time is running. Let's say you had a lease of 5 years to do a quarry, or you are mining some, what do you call them, expensive metals. Yeah, and the duration that you had agreed on in a contract is 3 years. And then let's say the drills or the machinery that you wanted to use, because of Corona, they have delayed. It means you will continue sinking in further losses as you wait for the machines to be shipped. And because you don't know when the pandemic will end, then this will be an unprofitable contract. So if the trustee sees such a scenario, they can disclaim, because it will put them in a worse off scenario than when they were partaking this bankruptcy. Then we have the other property which are not readily saleable by reason of the liabilities attaching there. For example, if the bankrupt was servicing a mortgage and the documents of the mortgage are with the bank, there is no way that the trustee will be able to transact such an item. Yeah. Then we have the time for disclaimer. The trustee may also disclaim in writing at any time within 12 months after the appointment or becoming aware of the property. But if it is extended by the court, then that will take effect. Then we have the disclaimer of leases. And we say in principle or in practice, where the bankrupt is a lessee, we have a lessor and a lessee. So a lessee is someone who has undertaken a lease. Yeah. If bankrupt is a lessee, the lease cannot be disclaimed without leave of the court. Reason being, you are going to jeopardize the lessor. It is like a case of landlord and tenant, and we are going to see thereafter. So if the property is not sublet or mortgaged, its real value should be less than 400 shillings per annum. Or the estate is being administered summarily. In other words, we are saying it is being taken as a separate entity. Yeah, or the trustee serves notice of the intention to disclaim on the lessor, and the lessor does not within 7 days require the matter to be brought to court. That will be a gentleman's agreement. So if there is such an agreement and we have this property that is in disrepute, then the trustee can go ahead and disclaim. Now, there are those rights that arises on the disclaimer. We say that any person interested in the property that is disclaimed may go ahead and sue, yeah, for order vesting the property in themselves. But the court will not make any vesting order in respect of the lease unless the lease is taken subject to the same liabilities that are binding this bankrupt person. And we say that any person who is injured by the disclaimer may prove in the bankruptcy to the extent of his loss. And this is in the law of tort. If you recall, in the law of tort, we say that a tort is an act of omission that may give rise to an injury. I'm not saying bodily harm. Injury could be pecuniary or monetary. So if I'm putting you in a worse-off situation that you were at the beginning of the bankruptcy, you can go ahead and prove. And to that extent, your loss might be met in the adjudication. Then we have what we call the provable debts. All debts and liabilities, present or future, certain or contingent, either the individual or together, are provable in bankruptcy. But there are those scenarios that you may not be able to prove. For example, unliquidated damages in a tort. Let's say the bankrupt person had sunk a borehole in his land. And this borehole has affected, let's say, the surface run of water on the neighbor's property. And there is an ongoing case. If it's not been liquidated, we may not be able to prove such a debt. Then debts incurred after the creditor had notice of an available act of bankruptcy. Again, we may not know why the creditor is bringing this when the notice has already been availed. Then the third scenario will be debts incapable of being fairly estimated. Some debts, you cannot really tell how, or you cannot really evaluate all value. You cannot attach any value to them. Then you have the debts that are incurred after the date of the receiving order. Now, if you are aware that you are transacting with a bankrupt person, you cannot, again, come and claim or prove that the bankrupt person had a debt with you. Then we have debts void of enforceable under the ordinary law of contract. This is obvious. And then maintenance payable by a husband to his wife. You say being bankrupt will not deny you the right of being a human being. So if you are providing for daily upkeep, you have dependents in form of wife and children, those will continue. Then we go the guarantees, the obvious bills of exchange, annuities, and we know annuities are these, the constant periodical payments that will keep on streaming in. So that's not a big deal. Then we have the interest. Interest may be claimed up to the date of the receiving order, if they are payable, that is, and should be shown in the agreement or by an existing statute. If the debt was created in writing and it is due after a certain time, you'll be given 6%, in excess of 6% from the due date. Otherwise, after the written demand for the payment giving notice, that interest is claimed at 6% per annum from the date of demand. In other words, you are trying to say interest over 6% per annum are taken as deferred debt. Yeah? Although in the case of now a money lender, the trustee can admit through the proof of there being a full amount. But for the other assets, we can only talk of a deferred debt. Then you got what you call the mutuo dealings, and mutuo means two-way. Yeah? So there will be a right to settle, if allowed, mutual credit, debts, or other dealings resulting in pecuniary liabilities. Pecuniary means monetary, or between the debtor and the creditor in the same right. Yeah? Or prior to the date of the receiving order. Of course, this were is like the bankrupt was operating normally, and therefore they had a right to enter into a contract or exit from a contract and make rightful decision, or without notice of an available act of bankruptcy. So if there was no notice from the official receiver, then we'll assume that anything that was happening thereof was a mutual dealing. To me, it was a win-win situation, and therefore the parties can agree on how to settle it out. Then we have the secured creditors. Now, secured creditors are those who rely on the security, and they can prove because they are clinging on the security. And a question that will be asked, and this is where a question will be asked in your exam, like a liquidator must distribute the assets in a prescribed order. And then you'll be asked, explain the order. Or if it is a multiple question, is a multiple choice question, you can be asked to choose which one of the orders given is the correct order. And the correct order will always be, this is how we classify debts. We go to the highest priority. So we start with the debts that are secured by a fixed charge. We proceed to the preferential debts. And by preferential, I mean, we have the preferential. Preferential means they are preferred or they come before the others. For example, let's say when the trustee took the property of the bankrupt, there were those administration costs that were involved in trying to keep the property afloat so that the debts that the property had secured by a fixed charge do not run into losses. To me, those administration costs will be preferential before we go now to the preferred debts. Then, of course, you are going to have the liquidation expenses that will be involved in trying to liquidate this particular property. Then we have the debt secured by a floating charge. So we started by a fixed charge. We went to the preferential. Then we are talking of the liquidation expenses or the expenses that were involved. Then from there, we have the reason why we are doing this is the trustee should not bear the incidence of liquidating the property. In other words, we say, if let's say there is a house that is worth 300 million and the liquidation cost is 2 million, 2 million ought to be loaded in the pricing of the property so that the trustee will be able to foot the bill or the cost of liquidation and go ahead now and foot the debts that were secured by a floating charge. And from there, we can now go to the unsecured debts. Then we have what we call the deferred debts or the doubtful, what you are not sure whether will be paid or otherwise. And then the last person to enjoy as a creditor are the shareholders. And the reason why we are talking of the shareholders, this is in cases of the incorporated companies, they should have seen the signs before the company or the corporate was put under receivership or under a trustee. They were supposed, and this is the reason why limited companies are supposed to do annual books of accounts, so that if there is any indicator, and for your information, the annual statement is just statutory. A company can decide to be doing weekly management accounts. And we expect that the manager will be the first person to see the signs of winding up or being put under receivership. And that's why shareholders are the last in the paying trail. Yeah? So when we are talking of the secured creditors, we are talking of those who rely on security and they can prove. Yeah? And they can even surrender the security and prove that this full amount was owned by that debt. Yeah? Then what will happen is the trustee will realize the security. And if they realize it at higher value, let's say, for example, you had a mortgage. The mortgage was, let's say, costed at 25 million. The bankrupt person had paid 15 million. So the outstanding mortgage is 10 million. If the creditor proves that the money that is remaining is 10 million, and the trustee is able to liquidate this mortgage or the house at 15 million, the net or the 5 million is supposed to revert back to the bankrupt. So it's a win-win situation. And we should make sure that the timelines that have been stipulated in the Bankruptcy and Insolvency Act are well observed. We are being given a duration of 28 days. And these 28 days, it is divided into 14-14. So you can check. Then we have the landlord. I was talking about the case of the landlord. And the landlord has a right of distress. Of course, the landlord right to distrain for arrears of any pending rent is not lost when the tenant becomes bankrupt. But distress can only be levied after commencement of the bankruptcy for up to 6 months. To mean, I cannot be bankrupt and you continue subletting to me a house. What will I pay you with? How will I pay? I'm already declared bankrupt. So the bank will give you a duration of 6 months. Maybe they are giving this time so that the bankrupt can go ahead and give the statement of affairs or what you are calling the arrangement. If they give an arrangement or a deed of arrangement on how they are going to meet their rent, this can be prolonged. Otherwise, 6 months. Now, if distress is levied within 3 months preceding the date of the receiving order, proceeds are subject to first charge in favor of the preferential creditor. So you can see how law is fair. In other words, we are saying that if the distress was levied, of course, you expect that these are annuities that I was talking about. In our society, we expect that if you're in a rental property, you're supposed to be meeting your obligation monthly. So month one goes, you're unable to pay. Second month goes, you're unable to pay. Third month goes, you're unable to pay. The landlord should ask themselves a question, whether chances of redeeming that rent are there. In most occasions, they are going to lose it. And that's why we are saying, if the distress was levied within the first 3 months preceding the receiving order, they'll be treated as preferential creditors. Now, if the landlord suffers a loss as a result, he acquires the same right of priority as the preferential creditor who are paid. Yeah? The reason why we are putting this person as a priority, as a preferential creditor, is because whatever they are catering for is a basic need. And we say it by being bankrupt, you are not being denied any human right. You have a right to food, you have a right to shelter, you have a right to clothing. You cannot walk naked because you are bankrupt. Are we there? So you are expected that the basic or those things that you cannot live without, the needs, they are given a priority. And where there was a distress, they'll be met as preferential creditors. So the landlord can distrain for rent after adjudication if the trustee remains in possession and does not disclaim lease. Are we there? So unless the landlord has distrained, he has no priority over the creditors. So he must have seen the distress and distrained himself from the same. Then there are those people who try to take the advantage of the confusion. And they want to bring in the debts when you are bankrupt. So there's something we call proof of debts. And there are some rules that apply. Now, a creditor has no right to vote or receive dividends until his debt is proved to the satisfaction of the trustee. When you give trustee the properties of the bankrupt, we expect that this person will act in good faith. He's like the fiduciary officer of the bankrupt. So any creditor who comes by, they must prove that indeed they are owned by the bankrupt. So proofs are supposed to be, and it is thick. Some you have to go and swear an affidavit, because if it is realized that it was fraudulent conveyance, you can be on the wrong side of the law. That's why we are talking of the trustee must deal with a proof. And this is stipulated for only 28 days. So after I receive the proof, within 28 days, I'm supposed to substantiate and go back to the court and say, indeed, this parcel was owned by the bankrupt. So the trustee must satisfy himself that there is a real debt before they go ahead and pay. And the trustee is not bound by any judgment or what we call the estoppel against the debtor. By estoppel, or this the, when we talk of estoppel, this is the term in law. And it is the principle in which, or the principle that precludes a person from asserting something contrary to what is implied by the previous action. In other words, by estop, when we talk of estoppel, we are preventing from going back. Are we there? In other words, we do not want to go back. If anything, there should be a proof. So when we say that the trustee must satisfy himself that there is a real debt, he's not supposed to go back or be bound by any judgment. And that doesn't stop them from going back against the debtor. So the trustee may apply to the court to expunge or reduce a debt that is wrongfully admitted. If they realize that there is someone who was trying to do some fraudulent conveyance, they can easily lock you out. So you can see the power or the privilege that has been given to the trustee. It is immense. Then there is proof of contingent debt or a debt that is together, that is not certain. For example, maybe such a debt could be admitted for dividend purposes, but not for voting. So when we are talking of the contingency, we can only bring them together, but this does not give the owners of the debt a voting right. For example, 10 creditors come together and then they want to vote as one. That is not possible, because this one person, when the deaths are brought together and they say they accumulate to 10 million, and there is some other people who are holding 2 million, 2 million, 5 people, by only raising his hand, he'll have stopped all the other 5. You get the power of voting, because it is rated dependent on the significance of the debt. Then you have what we call the double proof. Double proof is not allowed when proofing the debt. So in bankruptcy, we say proof may be against two separate estates, but they cannot be doubled. Are we there? So I had posted a question on the priority of meeting the obligations by the trustee. And this is the order, so that you know. We first meet the costs and charges that were properly incurred in administering the estate. So the trustee will not bear the burden of administering the estate, because he was doing so to avail the money to clear the creditors. It's closely followed by, so we are talking of the fixed charges. They are given the priority. Once we clear them, we have the preferential debts. So these are the debts that have to be given a priority. For example, if the bankrupt dies, don't you think burying him is a priority? We shouldn't entertain the dead person, because, for example, if they are put in a morgue, in a mortuary, they'll continue accumulating more costs. So proper funeral expenses are supposed to be put there. This is a dead person and he's bankrupt. So the more we stay with him, the more he becomes a liability. Then if there are any premiums paid by the apprentices, and these are skilled, if there are any premiums that were being paid for some skill, for example, let's say this person was a doctor. Doctor to mean whatever the skills that they were holding is not transferable, and they were making them to earn. So there's something that they were contributing in the professional body. So that should be given a preference before the preferential debts. Are you getting where I'm coming from? Then property of a friendly society. Let's say this guy was in a charitable organization. He shouldn't punish those people who were benefiting from his charity. Therefore, they'll be sorted out before we go to the preferential debts. Of course, expenses that were properly incurred by the trustee while coming up with the deed of arrangement. He was doing this in good faith. But there's something we call abatement. If the funds are insufficient, this person can dispose of the properties of the bankrupt. The trustee can dispose of the properties of the bankrupt, but they are unable to meet the preferential debts. They should be decreased ratably. In other words, we are saying they should be prorated. Prorated in a manner that those who had a higher share will get a higher share. It's a win-win situation. And from there, we go to the preferential debts. And this basically falls in the category of the government. So after you die, you buried you, you settled the charitable bodies, you come to the government. So unasikia mkono ya serikali ni mrefu. So before you go to the other creditors, you have to meet all the statutory requirements. You have to pay, if, for example, you are living in a government house and there were some rental arrears you want to clear. If you are owing some amount to the NSSF, you have to clear, assuming you are bankrupt for a whole year. Yeah. And let's say your contribution to NSSF is 1,400. You are going to get the 14,000 plus 28. Yeah. So we expect 16,800 to be paid to the government. Then amounts due to compensation and a workman's compensation, any statutory. Again, if the funds will be insufficient to pay in full, we again decrease them ratably. So when we talk of abate, to abate is to decrease proportionally. Yeah. Then from there, now we go to the unsecured debts, and the unsecured debts will be ranked equally after payment of the preferential debts in full. You see, you had a trust in this person. That's why you did secure your debt. So you are exposed. It was a win-lose situation. You could win, you could lose. Then we have the deferred debts. Deferred debts could be accrued interest. And because we don't want, again, this to be exploited, they are given at 6% annum. Yeah. Then we have the salary and wages due or money. You know, when you start now becoming bankrupt, the people who support you, the support system, you find there are those people who are closer. Or when you are talking of the consanguinity or the degree of consanguinity, you'll find your father, mother, brother, sister, if you don't have stepbrother, stepsister, those people who are in your bloodline will be the first to come through. Yeah? So they're supposed to be considered in the deferred debts. Then from there, loans to a person for business purposes. If people had given you some money so that you run a business and pay back, this should again be ranked equally. Then if there are any statutory interest that you're supposed to pay out of the deferred debts should be considered. And also the claims that were arising under the settlement by the trustee. If there are any claims that were forthcoming, they should also be cleared. And of course, from there, any surplus remaining, assuming that the process is seamless, and we've cleared all the manner of debts, the last person to be cleared in outstanding debt is the shareholder. So any surplus remaining after payment of all the debts and liabilities are returned out to the bankrupt person. So this is a question that you'll be asked. You'll be asked to give the order or priority in which the debt is supposed to be, or the process that the liquidator must distribute the assets to the creditors. You said you start with the debt secured by a fixed charge, followed by the preferential debts. No, pre-preferential. There are those pre-preferential, for example, the funeral expenses, name them. Then we go to the preferential debts. Then liquidation expenses, then debts secured by a floating charge. Yeah. Then from there, we go to the unsecured debts. From the unsecured debts, we go to the deferred debts. And then from the deferred debts, we go to the shareholders, if it is a company. Yeah. And if there's any surplus, the trustee will now come back with that money and deposit in your accounts, in the bankrupt's accounts. We'll be coming to that later on. Yeah? So that is according now to the provisions of the insolvency and the bankruptcy code. How we call it the IRP, the insolvency resolution process, should follow that manner. Now, if there are any dividends that were accruing, now the dividends are supposed to be following the rules, the rules that are highlighted here. And this is something that you can go through. And then, of course, you have the small bankruptcies. And small bankruptcies, the court may order the estate of a debtor to be administered summarily or separately if the debtor's assets are not likely to exceed 12,000 shillings in value. In other words, there is no need of commingling all the properties, let's say worth 500,000, if your standing bankruptcy is 12,000. You get. So these such amounts are called a small bankruptcy. So when I ask you to define what is a small bankruptcy, I don't expect you to give me the definition of bankruptcy. Are we together? So when we talk of the small bankruptcy, we are talking of a scenario where the assets are likely not to exceed some given amount of money, and the law is stipulating it at 12,000. 12,000 is like 1,000 per month. So a small bankruptcy differs from an ordinary bankruptcy in the following respects. You can see the OR is a trustee. We don't need to appoint a trustee. No committee of inspection is a cost. The proceedings need not be advertised in the local newspaper. By the way, gazetting will cost you 14,000. Why should you pay 14,000 if the debt is 12,000? It beats logic. So this is common sense. So the court may adjudge the debtor forthwith if no composition of a scheme of arrangement is proposed to clear the small bankruptcies. So the first meeting of the creditors may be held at the same time as the public examination. Hii ni pesa kidogo unaweza kuja nao kwa mfuko na ulipe utoke kwa shida. So a notice of subsequent meeting need not be sent. It's a cost again. Yeah? And the claim should again not cost more than 40 shillings. We are trying now to manage this person. He's unable to manage his finances. Right? Then if only some simple bookkeepings will be needed here. We just need to know what is the amount, how it is owned, and how it will be cleared. So cost other than the solicitors that need not to be taxed because it's little money. Actually, you are given a waiver. And the court consent is not required to disclaim leases or mortgages that were held. And then we have what we call the DOA. And DOA, I want you to tell me what is the need of the deed of arrangement. That is the activity that I leave you with. You can go through the manuscript and you give me the need of the deed of arrangement. With a few remarks, I want to end it at that point. We meet next week. You have any question? Post it the question in the portal and get back to you. Enjoy your evening.